show. Joining us now is our friend, the former ambassador to the United Nations, John Bolton. Mr. Ambassador, welcome as always.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me. Glad to be with you.
Well, it's my pleasure. Okay, so here we go on the Edward Snowden case. The federal prosecutors charge him with three felonies, executed a warrant, if you will, and asking for extradition from Hong Kong. Instead, Hong Kong lets him fly to Russia. The White House saying today, they presume he's in Russia, even though we've heard reports of planes to Cuba and maybe Ecuador, but they presume he's in Russia as far as they know. They're looking for cooperation with the Russians, and Jay Carney even went on to say, you know, we cooperated in the Boston Marathon, and now we're talking about reducing nuclear weapons. So he's kind of like begging, please, please help us because we like you and you like us. But he said about China that this unquestionably damages U.S.-China relations. So there's a lot there that I threw out on the plate, but please weigh in, if you will.
Well, you know, we're still in the middle of this, wherever Snowden is. I think most people think he's still in Moscow, but who really knows? The fact is that as of now, he's still loose. We couldn't get him in Hong Kong or China. He's in Moscow now. We don't know what the outcome will be there. But you can bet if he gets to Cuba, he is beyond our control at that point. And, you know, I would have to say, based on what we know, despite the administration's rhetoric, the reality is that he's made it from Hawaii to Hong Kong and Hong Kong at least on to Moscow without us being able to stop him. And it raises a lot of questions. You know, this is not simply or even primarily a matter of judicial procedure, the Justice Department filing a request for extradition in Hong Kong courts. This is fundamentally a matter of executive power in China, in Russia, and elsewhere. And you have to ask, who called whom in China and Russia? Did the president call President Xi Jinping in China? Did John Kerry call his counterparts? Have they called Vladimir Putin and Sergei Lavrov in Russia? Or are they leaving it to lower-level officials? How strong is the message that they're conveying? And does anybody believe in those two countries, even if the message is strong, that under Barack Obama there will actually be consequences if they ignore the United States? I mean, these are all things that that people need to keep in mind. I'll just underline again, obviously, this is still ongoing. We don't know everything the administration has done. But I've got to believe if the president were really involved in it, by God, you'd hear that. You know, he got up, he picked up the phone, he did this. You'd know it minute by minute. So far, the White House is silent.
Yeah, and it's interesting, Jay Carney reiterated more than once, and he said, I want to say again that we've cooperated with Russia on law enforcement when it came to the Boston Marathon and on other issues, as if he's trying publicly to convince Putin and the Russians that if he is still in Russia, to help the United States get him. So let's focus on Russia first. And you just wrote a piece in Foreign Policy Magazine on trusting the Russians on treaties and other issues. What do you think Putin will do here if, in fact, he's in Russia and if, in fact, he knows where Snowden is and does control him? Will he stick a finger in the eye of Obama in the United States, or will he cooperate?
Well, it depends on whether he thinks he can get away with it. And, you know, here the president presses the famous reset button in the relationship with Russia at the beginning of the administration, gives away our position on missile defense, gives away our position on the level of strategic nuclear weapons, gives away a lot of issues involving the territory of the former Soviet Union. And at the end of 4 years, the Russians are still looking for that famous flexibility that the president promised then Russian President Medvedev. And they say the reset button hasn't worked, so they want more concessions, and the president goes off to Berlin and promises some more concessions on nuclear weapons. I think Putin keeps his eye on the ball, and I think he's going to make a cold-blooded calculation. If he thinks he's going to be better sending Snowden on to Cuba because it shows he can push Obama around, he'll do it. If he thinks he might actually face consequences, then he may turn him over to us and claim credit for it to get more concessions on something else. I think he thinks Obama's a weak negotiator and a weak president, and he's going to maximize Russia's take out of this, whatever he does. It may well be the delay in Snowden's leaving is the Russians are debriefing him on what he knows about our espionage inside Russia, in which case, Putin could get the best of both worlds. He gets a dump from Snowden on that subject, And then he gets a political win whichever way he goes on Snowden's location.
I was going to say, with the political decision, it's a win-win, and then the bonanza is debriefing him the way probably the Chinese debriefed him. Now let's talk about the Chinese. When the White House says that this damages unquestionably U.S.-China relations because they did not live up to the treaty, the extradition treaty, what do you say?
Well, you know, the proof is in the pudding here. I'm glad to hear the rhetoric. Now I want to see what they do. And that's part of Obama's credibility problem, because for 4.5 years, people have defied the United States with impunity. And it's not a stretch to say that looking at the fact that now 9 months after the killing of 4 Americans in Benghazi on September the 11th, by terrorists with no retaliation whatever, people are saying to themselves, you know, if the U.S. gets upset over its ambassador to a country and 3 of his colleagues being murdered in cold blood and they don't do anything about it, what do you think they'll really do if we let this guy Snowden skip the country?
No.
You know, you could forgive the Chinese for thinking it won't matter at all.
Right.
So the burden is on Obama here to show that he means what he says. You know, we remember the red line with chemical weapons in Syria.
Oh, yeah.
It took about six weeks to finally prove out. He needs to do something quickly with respect to China. And I tell you, if there's any chance that we have to get Snowden in Moscow, he ought to do something to China right now, to tell Vladimir Putin that he's serious about consequences. I just find it hard to imagine that Obama's got the spine to do much of anything, but, you know, we'll see what happens.
What, for instance, what could he do right now, in your opinion, sir, that would send a message to Russia?
The first thing I would do would be to send the message to China so the Russians would hear it.
I'd
pull our ambassador out of Beijing back to Washington for consultations. I'd pull our consul general out of Hong Kong back. I'd suspend all regular diplomatic contact with the Chinese. I'd suspend all military discussions, all military visits. I'd cut back on every official communication I could think of to show our displeasure. Then I'd look for things like trade issues, specific, the day-to-day issues of diplomacy, where I'd start imposing costs on China. And then I'd think of some bigger things the Chinese want that I wouldn't give them.
One more for you, Mr. Ambassador. We're talking to Ambassador John Bolton here on the Steve Malzberg Show. The election of Barack Obama, you know, the first one, the second one, but especially the first one, was supposed to, you know, ensure that we would regain credibility in the world. And everything Obama has done or hasn't done with foreign policy was to regain credibility, to be likable, to cooperate with the world of nations. So why are they treating us this way?
Because they don't think we've got a president who understands the world at large, who doesn't pay attention to international affairs, who's fundamentally weak, and who believes that it's American strength that's part of the problem in the world, not American weakness. And so what both our friends and our adversaries do when they see a weak, inattentive president is they recalibrate their own policies, our adversaries to take advantage of us, and our allies to distance themselves so they don't feel the same pain.
Mr. Ambassador.